Thanks a lot for inviting me to this beautiful place. So I've been here before. I enjoyed a lot the neighborhood, the nature. And I'm very glad that I got the opportunity to talk about this condition, this common book I wrote with Felipe Cooker a couple of years ago. So you may know, so actually my formation, if you want, was in complexity theory, and I spent some time working also in calcul formel, computer algebra, especially solving systems of polynomial equations. But there you realize that if you have bigger problems and you really want to solve problems exactly, you cannot get very far. On the other hand, there are people in numerical analysis, they can do marvelous things, but they don't compute exactly, they allow for errors. And so the question was whether it is possible to... Okay, they do marvelous things, but maybe the theory, from the point of view of a complexity theorist, is not so satisfactory. So the question was whether it's possible to build a framework which allows one to understand performance of algorithms and maybe even complexity. And this is, I learned about it maybe 20 years ago already when I got into touch with the group of Steve Smale and Mike Schub and so on, and I learned about it. And I think it's very beautiful. And in the end, I managed to write this book with Felipe Cooker that came out 3 years ago. And the key actor is condition. Okay, it's about condition. I will explain you what I mean by this. And it turns out that if you study this notion, you can get quite a uniform view of things. So you can analyze algorithms in terms of condition. You can understand the performance in a probabilistic sense. And when doing so, you mix different areas. There is a geometric point of view. There is some probability. And I think it's beautiful. OK, so I have prepared this talk. You shouldn't be too frightened by this. Actually, what I did, I gave such a course some time ago in Switzerland. And I decided I will reuse some of these slides. So in Switzerland, they gave me 3 slots, not just 2. That's why I have 3 parts. And the book also has 3 parts. So the first part deals with linear system of equations. And I think there one can explain easily the basic ideas, some of the ideas. The second part is about linear inequalities, optimization. I will skip this here, but I still decided to put it, give it to you. You can have a look at it. And the third part is systems of polynomial equations. Okay, so let me start with this, with an overview. Very general. What is the motivation of all that? So it's the motivation is coming from actually computer science. So you want to understand the behavior of algorithms, and what people usually have done, they looked at the worst case. But there are some problems, some of them very, very famous, where with worst case, the answer you get is not satisfactory. So the most famous example is the simplex algorithm, where we know there are some very bad instances where the running time is exponential, but it doesn't seem to be happening very, very often. But of course, as a theoretician, you want to understand what's going on. So then, in order to understand this, the idea of average case complexity was born. The idea was, okay, you say your instances to your algorithms, you assume they follow some probabilistic distribution. You don't know which distribution. Usually you take one when you start with this that's easy to analyze, say Gaussian distributions. And then you try to prove something about the expected number of steps. And this was done for the first time for the simplex algorithm by Borgward, German mathematician. It was in 82 and almost at the same time, I think independently, by Smale, and they proved very good bounds. Okay, so that was quite a thing. But of course, the story didn't end there because practitioners said, well, Well, what do we know about the instances that we get in practice? They don't follow these distributions. And so they were looking for other ways to understand this. And the newer idea, now it's not so new anymore, it's already maybe 15 years ago, 14 years ago, is a new idea of analyzing algorithms, which was called smoothed analysis. So it's like, if you want, a blend of the ideas of average analysis and worst case. I will explain to you in a second what it is. It was proposed by two computer scientists, by Dan Spielman and Changhua Teng. Okay, they managed to perform an analysis of the simplex algorithm. They got, you know, a lot of distinctions for this work. So what is this? Actually, it's easy to explain. So let's say we have a function t, like time, if you want, from r to the p to the non-negative real numbers. It can be running time, but later on it will be rather something like condition number. Okay? So when you do average case analysis, you assume there is some distribution on your instance A, and then you want to prove it's unlikely that T of A will be large. Now, instead of doing that, you do something more sophisticated. You say, okay, let's take any A bar. You may think that this is the true value. And then you add some noise. So some slight random perturbation here. So this is fixed and this is random. And then you want to prove it's unlikely that T of this perturbed input will be large. And you want to prove that for any A bar. Okay, even if the A bar is ill-posed. So here is a diagram explaining these three options. Worst case is just the supremum, average case expectation, and smoothed analysis. I guess most of you have seen it, but if you see it for the first time, it takes some time to digest. So you have the supremum over all A bar of the expected running time. And here, in this formula, it is assumed that the A is a Gaussian with center A bar and some isotropic covariance matrices with standard deviation sigma. Okay, and you want to prove upper bounds on these quantities. Okay, that's the plan. That's the plan. Okay, it's not so easy to do this. So there are also other general ideas which go under the name of condition-based analysis. Right. So actually, this smoothed analysis, which was invented by Spielman and Teng for the simplex algorithm, the simplex is a rather combinatorial algorithm, but it turned out that you can apply it to a wide variety of numerical algorithms that are not combinatorial in nature. And even if you do that, it's even easier, I think, or cleaner. Okay, and the key idea for doing so, that you need some intermediate, like an intermediate actor, an intermediate quantity, and that's the condition. Okay, condition numbers are the key concept for doing this analysis. So what is a condition number? So most people know what is the condition number of a matrix. And if you go to the books in numerical analysis, you will find it in all books, but then soon it will be finished. Often you don't find the general definition. So condition numbers that quantify the errors when the input is, okay, has a small error. So it's we will see the precise definition. Okay, everybody has seen this as a definition, condition number of a matrix. Actually, condition number is always defined for a certain problem. It doesn't refer to an algorithm, it refers to a problem. And here, for a matrix, is the problem of matrix inversion or linear equation solving. Now, the idea is, if you have some numerical algorithm, iterative algorithm, the input is x, and epsilon is an accuracy that you want to have, t of x epsilon is the running time, you try to estimate the running time in terms of the size of the input, which is usually the number of parameters, the dimension, okay, the accuracy here, or logarithm of accuracy, and some quantity, which will be the condition. Now, this is just, you know, a meta statement. It's not a mathematical theorem. This stands for some polynomial bound that you want to prove. Okay, so we will see examples where this actually works. Okay, so by the way, if there are questions, feel free to interrupt me. I think we have enough time. And, okay, so once you had this idea, so now what you can do, okay, you split your work in two parts. First, you do this condition-based analysis. And after doing this, now if you have this bound, okay, but then of course the question is how good is the algorithm? It depends on the condition. So, but now comes the idea of this probabilistic analysis. You want to know now you want to prove that it's unlikely that this is big, is large, and then you get some theoretical certification that the algorithm is good. Now, this you can do in different ways. So I told you first was the idea of average case, and then this has been elaborated by many people. I put all the names here. Jim Demmel, Alan Edelman, Jim Reniger, Mike Shoup, Steve Smale, Mike Todd, others. So there has been a lot of work in that. Okay, but then there came this new idea of the smoothed analysis, and then of course you can naturally refine it. Okay, once you have this, you just have to change your way of probabilistic analysis. Okay, and then you get hopefully more meaningful results. And okay, several people have worked on that, some of them my students, and I will tell you about it. Smoothed analysis of condition numbers. Okay, and by the way, there is a new thing, another idea which came out quite recently, it's due to my former students, Dennis Amelungs and Martin Lotz, they came up with something they call weak average case analysis. It's yet another idea that you may have situations where the expectation of your running time is infinity, okay? But still, it works good. Then an idea is it's due to outliers. So the idea is to take away a set of exponentially small probability, remove it, then take the expectation and then get you decent results. And they have built some theory about it. The paper is online in the Journal of Complexity, but not published in print yet. But that's interesting. I won't have time to go into this in detail, but I think it's another, you know, this is theory. We don't know. I mean, we try all kinds of things to understand what's happening. That's another idea. Okay. So that was like the overview. Now let's go to more details. Let's go to the math. This morning we talked just about linear equalities. Okay, so there is a Turing's condition number of a matrix. You may know that almost at the same time, the end of the 40s, there were two papers, one by Alan Turing. At that time he was not famous yet. He wrote a paper where he analyzed this, and he even coined the name condition number, and more or less at the same time, John von Neumann, very famous already, he wrote a paper with Goldstein, trying to understand, he was thinking of computers, and he wanted to understand whether it's possible to solve a system of linear equations in the presence of errors. He also introduced these quantities. So it's interesting to see this, that the names of these founders of computer science related to condition. So it's a very old concept, actually. So here is the general definition. Actually, it's very easy to understand if you know a little bit of calculus. I assume I have some function f from r to the p to r to the q. Okay, we think it's related to it's a computational problem. And then we fix some norms here and here. And we want to measure errors. Okay, there are many ways to measure errors. Let's say we do it here norm-wise, relative error. So I assume x has some error delta x. I measure it in the norm, and I divide by the norm of x. So this is called norm-wise relative error. And then we do the same for the relative error of the output. And the question is how large is the magnification of the error? So roughly, we want to understand this number here. I will define it precisely in a second, but it's the worst case magnification of the relative error. So this is called the condition number then. So The precise, okay, you're a mathematician, you want to see formal definitions, you do it only in first order. So the precise definition is as follows: if you have a function that is differentiable, what you do actually, you take the derivative of f at x, it's a linear map, you take the norm. So this is just the operator norm of the derivative. It's defined because you have, if you have chosen a norm here and here, then this operator norm is this. And then you have this, you multiply with the norm of x and divide by the norm of f of x. This is just because you look at relative errors. If you look at here what we want, think for a second, then you see this is the right way to do it. And this is a rigorous definition. So it's something you can compute, okay, analyze. Okay. I never saw this in a book on numerical analysis, actually, but I think it's very easy and very clean. It's just calculus, okay? So now let's have a look. I mean, the first example is so what is the function? You have a matrix which is invertible. A, you map it to its inverse. Okay, that's an important problem. We want to invert a matrix. Maybe it's more important to solve a linear system, but this is maybe easier to write. And then, okay, we have to agree on norms. Let's say on both sides we use spectral norm. And then we see what we get. It's an exercise that everybody of you can easily do. You do an exercise, and then you prove, actually, what I defined before. This condition is exactly this familiar expression. Then it's not a definition, but that's what it is, okay? Norm of A times norm of the inverse. Okay, if you look at the definition, this is a scale invariant notion. This happens very often. This is due to the fact that I measure relative errors. Okay, and as that already was introduced by Turing. Okay, so now let's, I'm sure you all know this, but the idea is then to go on to more geometric interpretations, but there is this connection to eigenvalues. I think everybody should know, and I think you know it, but it's a course and I can, okay, I want to spend some time off the basics. So we take the matrix A transpose times A. It's a symmetric matrix. So we have real eigenvalues. I order them. And then easy to see, norm of A square here, this formula. And I see, everybody knows, the lambda 1, okay, the largest eigenvalue is the squared spectral norm of A, okay? Then I play the same game for the inverse, okay? Then if I take the inverse, these are the eigenvalues of the inverse. And I see the inverse of A norm squared is this. So what I see, the condition number is the following. It's a ratio of you have the largest eigenvalue divided by the smallest eigenvalue square root. And actually you shouldn't think about eigenvalues. Rather, you should think about singular values. So the square root of this guy here, of the largest eigenvalue of A transpose A, is the largest singular value, and this is the smallest singular value. So the condition number is this ratio of largest and smallest singular value. I think we all know that. It's at least one. Okay, you know that? Okay, this is one aspect. Now, something very important is the link to geometry. So trying to understand this condition number, which was defined in terms of calculus, you can understand it in a geometric way. So you identify a set of ill-posed problems where you cannot solve your problem. In our example, it would be the problem to invert a matrix. Well, if the matrix is singular, you cannot invert it. So let's see, sigma is the set of in singular matrices. These are the ill-posed instances of our matrix inversion problem. Now you see A is in sigma if and only if the determinant of A equals zero. So you see sigma is a real algebraic set, zero set of the determinant, which gives some link to algebraic geometry. And there is the Eckhard-Young theorem. I think all of you have seen it as well, which says that, okay, the norm of the inverse, the spectral norm of the inverse, is 1 over the distance of A to sigma. So maybe some chalk, maybe I can make a drawing here. It's I like to see it. Okay. I like these simple pictures. So let's say here is my matrix and here is sigma, then I have a distance, okay? The smaller the distance, the closer I get to sigma, the higher is the condition number, okay? So you see in the definition of the of A, in the condition number of A, the norm of A also plays a role, but you can always assume, I mean, you can do some scaling and you can assume that this is, okay? Norm is 1, and then you see the condition number of A. This is 1 over the distance of A to sigma. And then it turns out you can, for distance, you can measure either in operator norm or Frobenius norm. Doesn't matter. Frobenius norm is you get when you interpret your matrix as a large vector. So this is the Frobenius norm. Okay. This is nice to have the Frobenius then, and then you have like a Hilbert space structure. So I have this. So this is something we should keep in mind. Okay, another aspect is the aspect of finite precision computation. When you have compute with real numbers on a computer, you use floating point arithmetic, so you produce errors all the time. Okay? So condition, of course, has to do something with that, and I will explain you in 2 examples. So let's say epsilon is the round-off unit, maybe 10 to the minus 12. So what you do, right. So let's say I have x, but actually what I get is only an approximation, and delta stands for the relative error. So x tilde will be x times 1 plus delta, okay? So you cannot have, if you are in this floating point arithmetic, the best you can hope for is for a delta with at most 1/2 the epsilon here. You cannot get closer, okay? So, and then there is this name Nicolas proposed. It's called, I think in the literature, people call it loss of precision. He said maybe want you call it loss of accuracy, whatever. So you take this name, you take the quotient delta over machine, round-off unit, and take the logarithm, maybe to the base 10, not important, and this is called the loss of precision. It's like the loss of digits that you encounter, okay? Right, so now this is just the naming, and then I just give you an example that the role of condition numbers here when in connection to loss of precision. So it's relevant for finite precision analysis of linear algebra. Okay, here is an example. I won't go to the details, I'll just tell you the result. Like, let's do QR factorization. So it's one of the main algorithms in numerical linear algebra, and some people took the work and analyzed it with regard to fine round-off. That's not so easy, okay? So here, but this is a theorem. So let's see what it is. So you have, the input is an invertible matrix, A, and then you have a B, and then you want to solve your system AX equals B, and you do it with a certain algorithm. Whatever it is the algorithm using householder QR factorization. Okay, we don't go into the details, but one can prove if you do it, if you analyze this algorithm, the computed solution X tilde has a loss of precision that you can bound this way. So this is the loss of precision, okay? And you see what you get, 2 times log n plus logarithm of the condition number of A. C is some constant. So you see this quantity here is relevant for the precision of your output, okay? It's important to understand, maybe you do understand all that, but when I entered it, I understood nothing. I mean, and you have to understand that the condition number only depends on the problem. Now, proving the theory means analyzing an algorithm. It depends on the algorithm, not just on the problem. But the magic is that here, this depends on the algorithm, but it can be upper bounded by something that only depends on the problem. Okay, that's important to make this distinction. Okay, so this is an example to convince you how important this condition number is. Here's another example, also very important, method of conjugate gradients. So you have I have a rectangular matrix, full rank, m by n, m is larger than n. And I want to solve a least square problem. Okay, how we learn in numerical analysis how to do it. We can find this solution by solving this system, Sx equals b, and S is the symmetric matrix. Okay, and so S is symmetrically positive definite. Then there is this method of conjugate gradients. I won't tell you what it is, but probably I've seen it. It's an iterative method for solving this system here. And the cool thing is that there is an analysis of the algorithm in terms of the condition number, which is due to Stiefel and Hestenes. So they proposed the algorithm, and they also analyzed it. And their result says, this method of conjugate gradients, if you want to achieve a relative error epsilon, you only need that many iterations. And so what you see here, you have square root of the condition number times logarithm of 1 over epsilon. So this is I show it to you as a concrete example for something we call condition-based analysis. Okay? This is from. Okay. So it bounds the number of steps. Okay. So this was, right. Now I want to move to the topic. Now I talked about condition-based analysis. Now I want to show you some ideas about probabilistic analysis, okay? So probabilistic analysis of Turing's condition number, average case analysis. Again, there was another paper by John von Neumann and Hermann Goldstein. You see, it was a little bit later. It was after the war. Numerical inverting matrices of high order, and that's quite remarkable. In that paper, it's the first time you see such an analysis. So they assumed that the matrices are random, used Gaussians, and then they analyzed, in a probabilistic way, how bad it can be. So it's quite a technical paper, but it's very interesting. Okay, you may know that these guys were not so optimistic about it. It was not so. If it's interesting to read it, they were not so optimistic that you can really solve large systems, because they were afraid that this round of error produce a lot of problems. So nowadays people don't worry about it anymore. We just compute and we know it works fine. But it was not clear to these people, these pioneers of computers. Because at that time, the computers were not in existence yet, or only very primitive form. Okay, so the easiest thing to do is, let's take a random matrix. The entries are independent, standard Gaussian, simple situation. So what is known? Of course, has been very well studied. So the condition number, as I said, it can be expressed in terms of the eigenvalues of A transposed A. So here almost everything is known. So we take this matrix, A transpose A. Now the distribution of this symmetric matrix has a name. It's called the Wishart distribution. Has been studied in very much detail in statistics, multivariate statistics. So what is known it's nice to see the eigenvalues, lambda 1 up to lambda n of this Wishart distribution. They have a joint probability density that has this form due to these guys. So I don't know, how many of you have seen this? Raise your hand, this formula. Only André Galigo, nobody else. Okay, good that you're here. So you see the density, let's have a look at it. It's quite nice. So here, this expression, it's the product. I assume now the eigenvalues are ordered. So I have the product of the differences of the eigenvalues. So it's it's a determinant of the van der Monde. You see, if two eigenvalues collide, then they get zero, okay? And then you have this product of this thing here. And of course, very important is here coming from the fact that you have a Gaussian distribution. So the density becomes zero if lambda is on our sigma. If the determinant of the matrix is zero, you have density zero. Okay? It's kind of unlikely that you have this. But this is a quantitative way of saying it. Now, the hardest thing in this form is the constant. I don't show it to you because nobody can remember it. It's complicated. Okay. So this is also important in physics. So Wigner, Eugen Wigner, got quite famous working in this. So it looks like we just have to put things together, but it's not so easy if you have this distribution and you want to understand the distribution of lambda 1 over lambda n. This takes some work. So Alan Edelman has worked on that. That was in his PhD thesis. For instance, he proved the following. We have this. He had this result, the probability that the condition number of A is greater than or equal nx. So you put, in order to get a nice result, you have to scale appropriately. So that's why you have this n here, and you let n go to infinity. Then you get a limit, which he was able to express precisely. So that's a sophisticated result. I just show it to you, it exists, because I want to tell you easier things. This is too complicated for us. But I just tell you, one can do it. He did it. And then once you have this precise result, you can also find a bound on the expectation of the logarithm of the condition number. Remember, the logarithm of the condition number entered the analysis of the QR algorithm. So he proved the expectation is log n plus constant plus O of 1. It's work, and then you see, you get some, theoretical explanation why QR factorization is good. The average loss of precision is just 3 times log n. So this is complicated. Now what is, you see, and the condition number of a matrix is not the most complicated object. It's the beginning. So I'm looking now for easier ways to analyze condition numbers, actually geometric ways, The bounds that I get are not that sharp, but the method is easy and it generalizes, That's the plan, and there I will also show you more details, Now hopefully that, So this is the link to geometry. I like this very much, this part of the talk. It's easy to explain. Instead of having Gaussians, we reduce to a sphere. So here again, I define a modification of the condition number, which I call Frobenius condition number. I put here the F. So the difference is just here. Instead of having the spectral norm of A, I put the Frobenius norm. So I get something that is a little bit larger. But I don't care. The good thing, why this? Well, with respect to the Frobenius norm, which is essentially the Euclidean norm on vectors, if I consider the matrices as vectors, I have a sphere. So the sphere consists here of those matrices with Frobenius norm 1. Now what happens? So if I have my matrix A, I normalize it. B is a matrix of Frobenius norm 1. What happens with the distribution? This was too fast. So if I have here a standard Gaussian, the distribution of B will be just a uniform distribution on the sphere. Will be the uniform distribution on the sphere by isotropy. Then we can go back to this formula here. So the condition number I said by the Eckard-Young. Here you see it's 1 over the distance of B to sigma, but the norm of this is 1, so it's this, So actually we are exactly in this situation. Instead of A, I write B. But then we can rewrite the probability that the condition number of A is larger than 1 over epsilon. It's the same as the probability that the condition of B, I'm always talking now about Frobenius condition, greater than O epsilon. But this means, by Eckard-Young, that the distance, this is the probability that the distance of B to sigma is less than epsilon. Okay, meaning that, okay, so what you do here, okay, you look at the epsilon neighborhood, okay. So this is the, you look at the epsilon neighborhood of this sigma, okay. And you wonder what is the probability. You have the uniform distribution of the sphere, and you wonder what is the probability that my matrix ends up in this epsilon neighborhood, or sometimes we say epsilon tube. So I could not produce this picture. It was Dennis who did it. I always reusing it. Okay. Okay, we have here a sphere. The sigma is depicted as a curve, and then we have this epsilon neighborhood here. See, denoted this way, T stands for tube. Sigma S, sigma index S is because I intersected with the sphere. Okay, oh, what happened? Sorry. Okay. So here again. The probability that the Frobenius condition number is large is, so what is it? It's a volume ratio. It's the volume of the tube, the volume of this gray, I don't know, sausage or what, whatever, divided by the volume of S. So now I want to prove it's not too hard, not too big. So what can I do? I mean, of course, this volume of the sausage or the tube is not so easy to determine. But in first, now your epsilon is small. So in first order, what will it be? In this simple example, so in this simple example, you just take the length of the curve, and then you multiply with two epsilon. This should be more or less okay. Not okay. So up to some error, this should be the volume of sigma s. In this picture, it's the length of the curve times two epsilon divided by volume of s plus some error. Okay. So what I want to do now, I want to show you now how to estimate this quotient, volume of sigma divided by volume of s. Length of the curve divided by area of the sphere in the concrete setting. So how can we do that? Okay, so there are some nice ideas, general ideas for doing it. So, okay, more general. How about bounding the volume of the determinant hypersurface? So sigma is the zero set of the determinant. I want to apply some general principles. So the determinant is a homogeneous polynomial of degree d equals n. That's all we will need, okay? No more information. So it should be simple and general. So what I do, I take a plane P, plane is two-dimensional, in my big Euclidean space, and I intersect. So how about this intersection? How does it look like? But my polynomial is a homogeneous polynomial, so actually I restrict my homogeneous polynomial to a plane, and the zero set will be a collection of lines. Well, in some degenerate case, it can be the whole plane, but if I exclude this case, there will be finitely many lines, okay? And how many of them? Well, of most degree many. Okay, so it's either all of P, which is degenerate, or it's a union of K lines. K is at most a degree. It's just a basic thing about point zeros of polynomials. Homogeneous polynomials in two variables is as good as polynomials in one variable that are non-homogeneous. So, okay, but we are over the reals. We have to be careful a little bit. This is a real situation, okay? So you could have with positive probability, it could be that the intersection is empty. Almost surely it's empty, or it consists of 2D points, two of which are opposite. Okay? Over the complex numbers, this cannot be empty, but over the reals, it may happen. But we don't care. Now there comes a very beautiful result that from integral geometry. I think everybody should know. Okay, it's written here, but maybe I can explain it on the board. So what do we do? So we want to, you see, we are interested in this ratio here. Volume of sigma s divided by by what? So maybe I have to make a drawing. So this is my sphere. Then I have my curve. This is the sigma s. And I want to know the length of the curve. Okay? So what do I do? Actually, you take a random equator. Now, this was random, okay? This random equator. I know, I think random meaning that the north, say the north-south pole is just uniform on the sphere. Then you intersect and count how many points. Now this picture is, of course, in our situation, if you go from x to minus x, you get the same. It's not reflected in my drawing. I hope you don't mind. What I'm telling you is general. I count the number of intersection points. I would have 3. And then I take the expectation of this. The number of intersection points is a random variable. Now it turns out the expectation gives you the length of the curve. Somehow it makes sense. If your curve is wiggled a lot, okay, you get many points, it's longer. So actually, and the precise statement is here. Okay, now you may wonder about, so what is, this would, in my example, it would be the length of the curve divided by the length of an equator. In general, it's the volume of the hyperequator. Okay? And this is the, what is it? The expected number of intersection points divided by 2. So maybe you shouldn't worry too much about the scaling constant if you see it for the first time, but I think this result by Poincaré is so beautiful, you can explain it to your children. I tried. Works. Okay. Very beautiful. So then now the idea is, we need to upper bound this ratio now, so we have reduced it to a counting problem. Here we know, I mean, we know this is at most D. Okay, so we get it. So the volume here is D times the probability that my random plane meets sigma s, which is upper bounded by D. So it's very easy. So let's go on. Okay, now, actually, now a minor modification. Actually, we need to know the volume ratio of sigma to the volume of the big sphere. Okay, but actually what I got was this. So I need some correction factor accounting for this volume of the hyperequator divided by the volume of the whole sphere. And then if you look at what it is, it's not hard. Okay, then this is basically square root of the dimension of S. Whatever, not so important. Now, what is it? D equals n. The dimension of S is n squared, so I get in order of magnitude another n, so it will be an n squared, essentially, up to a constant. And we get, putting things together, we get this tail bound. The probability that the condition number is greater than 1 over epsilon is this, and we have bounded it this way. A constant, n squared, epsilon, plus some error. Without a lot of work, just using these principles. Very general. Now you see, if you compare it with Edelman's bound, of course the guy had a better bound, but his method was specific and we worked in generality. So this bound is, our bound is larger by a factor of n. Okay? So, okay, but also we worked with the Frobenius condition and not with, and he worked with the other condition. Okay. Then what one can do, actually, if you say, I want to remove this small o of epsilon, then you have to work. Okay, if you want to, not just asymptotic statement, you want an upper bound, then this first order estimation is not precise. So you have to think of the correction terms, and this can be done by using some techniques from differential geometry and volume of tubes. So the correction terms can be expressed in terms of curvature integrals, and one can bound this. It's all possible. Okay, but I won't enter it, but it's interesting. Can be done. Okay. And, well, the first who did this, he elaborated on this, was Jim Demel. He wrote quite an important paper in 1988 where he made very clear this connection. Okay. Good. Okay. Questions on this? Yes? Bernard.
The other terms of the expansion in terms of epsilon.
What it is?
You have a way to
compute. Yes. Yes. Actually, yes. There was a paper by Hermann Weyl on the volume of tubes from 1930. Hermann Weyl. So he wrote the paper on the volume of tubes. Well, if the radius is sufficiently small, he gave a formula in terms of curvature integrals. So it's not right. It's only for sufficiently small epsilon. And we did a paper with Martin Lotz and Felipe Cooker where we modified it a little bit. So we upper bounded these connection terms, but the good thing, it's valid for all epsilon. Instead of curvature integrals, you have to do integrals of absolute curvature. So you have to modify. It's basically the same idea, but you have to modify it a little bit. But then you have to bound it. Then you combine Bezout's theorem with integral geometry, you get upper bounds. It's interesting. So you can upper bound the integrals of curvature in the terms of degree only. I think it's not clear that you can do that. So, okay, but maybe we can discuss this offline. These are too much details for this course. Okay, now you see, just thinking of, we could apply this now, this insight. We had this method of conjugate gradients. You remember it? Yeah. But there is a problem. So we get, okay, that many iterations to achieve relative error epsilon. So what we proved, I mean, we had this upper bound. Now the probability that the condition number is greater than equal t is bounded by a constant n over t. Now, if you use this to bound the expectation, then the expectation is 1 over epsilon, because here is an integral 1 over t. If you integrate over 1 over t, it's infinity. So now you are in trouble. And you have this method, which works well, the conjugate gradients, and here the expected condition number is infinity. Well, it's inconsistent. So there's a problem here. So, of course, one has to think. I mean, there are several ways out of... So one is what I said at the beginning, what Dennis Samuelungs and Martin Lotz, this new idea about excluding the outliers. But I thought about it with Felipe some time ago. We had a different explanation. So here is a way out of the dilemma. It happened, actually, we wanted to write this book. We wanted to have good motivations and then came up with this and said, well, this cannot be... Then we thought about it. So the one possible explanation is that actually, when you apply conjugate gradient, you apply it to rectangular matrices. So R is rectangular, n times n, and m is usually much larger than n, like overdetermined least square problem. Then you form this S, R transpose R, but this is then just an n times n square matrix. And then it looks different. Now, if you have rectangular matrices, there are different results on the condition. So there is a result due to Gehmann and Silverstein. Now, okay, how can I explain this? I have a random Gaussian matrix of size Mn times n. And think of Mn is like Q times n, okay? And then they showed that almost surely the condition converges to something that is independent of n. This number here, it's just this expression, just in terms of the ratio, it's a constant. Okay, so before I had, for a square matrix, I had the log n for the expectation, but here it's constant because it's a very elongated matrix. It's different. So once you see this, then okay, good. This is some explanation. Then if you use this, then you see the expected number of iterations of conjugate gradient is independent of n and only depends on the ratio. So this is one possible way to explain this. Here is a number, 4n times n, this will be only 3. So how is my time? Huh? I use up a lot of time, I realize. How much more? But I have more time. I have half an hour or even more.
40 minutes.
Okay, no problem at all.
Including questions.
No problem at all. Okay, good. So, good. Then this is maybe another. Maybe you have a question here. Because now, you're right.
Is the condition never of inverse, or are you going to get
ready? Okay, can you repeat the question? Uh-huh.
Is it the condition never of the inverse here that you're talking about, or the condition never of the conjugate gradient?
Here I talk about, here, not of the, it's of the matrix R itself. No, it's the condition of R. The condition of R is the norm of R times the norm of the inverse of R. Okay, I mean, doesn't matter. I mean,
it's depends on
the algorithm. I'm talking about, I'm trying to understand performance of conjugate gradient, where I'm used the upper bound by Hastiness and Stiefel, where the square root of the condition of R enters. Yes. Okay. Okay, more? Yes?
In computation, you showed us earlier on the estimate on kappa on b, where did we lose, in comparison with Edelman's result, where did we lose the factor n?
I think it's the following, that maybe here? And we have here this Frobenius condition, where you put here this. Now you think you have to compare here. Maybe forget about the matrix. It's the difference between norm, between the maximum norm. Okay, now let's assume x is in R to the n. We have the maximum norm, and we have the L2 norm. And here, you see, now maybe it will be good to put here, capital N. Then you have this. So this, okay. Now the capital N in our example will be small n squared. And you have here a 1 over n. I think that's the responsible. C'est le coupable. Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. More questions on? Doesn't seem to be the case. Okay. Then I want to move on to the smoothed analysis. Now I want to show you that these ideas, that these geometric ideas, can be extended. So, okay, smoothed analysis. So. I said already what it is, but here it's in more detail. Let's talk about smoothed analysis of this matrix condition number. So what one would do, one has an A bar, use some sigma, standard deviation, and then here is the density of the isotropic Gaussian. I hope you have seen this. So this is just the density here. You are familiar, hopefully, with Gaussian distributions, okay? So this is isotropic in all directions. It's the same. So the covariance matrix will be just a multiple of the identity matrix. So we just have this symbol here for denoting this. So, okay. So it's a model for a small perturbation of A due to noise or round of error or whatever, okay? Now, if you want to do a smoothed analysis of the matrix condition number, we want to derive tail bounds on the kappa. And you actually want to have tail bounds that are independent of the center. So it's quite challenging, actually, maybe we do it because we can do it. I will make a drawing in a minute. So when doing this again, we may assume that this is norm one, scale invariance. So the first people who proved something on that were again Sankar, Spielmann, and Tang, they had results, moved analysis of the matrix conduction number, and then Mario Shebor improved that. And he proved this result. And I think it's a sharp result. So let's see what it is. So you have the supremum over all A bar. I assume that it is the norm is 1. And then here the probability that the condition number exceeds T under this distribution. And it's O of N over sigma T. And what is interesting, maybe even, you see, once, okay. You even allow, maybe this is, maybe it looks wrong, but it's okay. You can even allow that your A bar lies on sigma. It's a bad guy, but then you add a little bit of perturbation, okay? Now it will be Gaussian. And then the situation becomes a good one. That's what is written here. So sometimes people in PDEs told me that they call this regularization. I don't know nothing about it, but adding some noise is a good thing sometimes. Okay. So right, so but this Mario, he unfortunately passed away. He was a probabilist, and what he did is, you know, probability. There is an easier way to see this with somewhat worse bound, and I'm going to tell you in a moment how this works. But what are the implications of this, of the tail bound by Mario Shebor? As a consequence, one gets, before we had a tail bound, and here we have a bound on the expectations of the logarithms of the condition number, you get this, log over n over sigma. By the way, you should note that you have the 1 over sigma here, and it has to be there, okay? Because if sigma, also I can go back. You see, if sigma becomes 0 or almost 0, it's very large, but that's clear because it's like here, if sigma becomes 0, there is no noise anymore, and if it's sitting here, it must be bad. So there's no way you have to have this. Okay, right. So it gives some more compelling probabilistic interpretation of the success of several procedures in numerical linear algebra. Okay, I wrote some paper with Felipe where I was puzzled about the conjugate gradient, and then we looked at the rectangular case and we did some smooth analysis of the rectangular case. It's not so important, but here we did some. This is for the rectangular case. We even proved, that's quite strange, that instead of getting an upper bound where we at least have to log n, we got an upper bound where there was no n anymore. So the upper bound was just depended on the ratio between m and n, if I m times m. Kind of strange, but it's quite some time that we wrote that paper and I have forgotten about it. But this is a bit surprising. Okay, that's not so important. Let's maybe jump over that and rather spend our time for smooth analysis, geometric ideas. Okay, so result by Mario was based on ideas from probability, but I would rather do it with geometry. Okay, and this is possible. So again, we go back to that, and then I want to this idea that is still on the board, I just add some modifications, and you will see that we don't have to do a lot of work, and we get this. So, but what kind of distributions? Okay, Gaussian distributions are, of course, the best in many respects. They transform well and so, but now in this setting, in a geometric setting of a sphere, maybe another distribution will be helpful to deal with. So we decided to do the following. We look at spherical caps. So I have a spherical cap here, B, A bar, sigma. The center is A bar, and sigma is the radius in terms, okay, this is again something confusing. Okay, I will be, so. Okay, what do I do? Okay, so this will be maybe A bar. And then I have some angle alpha, okay? And I think of the spherical cap, but you should think of that, it should rotate, okay? It should rotate. And then actually the angle is alpha, but it turned out for all these bounds, it's better to express the forms in terms of sine alpha, which I denote sigma. But it's not important. It's roughly alpha. Okay, but this is just, that's why I say it's here is put the sigma, but the radius is arc sine of sigma. Not important. But what I assume now, I have a uniform distribution on this spherical cap. Okay, this is the model of probability. Okay, and we call this uniform smoothed analysis. Okay. Okay, then again, sigma equals null is worst case, then sigma equals one. When sigma equals one, this spherical cap becomes the whole sphere, it's average. So we have also a very clean transition between worst case and average. Okay, now we have to modify the geometric ideas. There's not so much to do, let's see. Again, we have our sphere, we have our sigma, and then this shaded one is the spherical cap. Now our point is uniformly chosen here. And what the question is now, what is the probability that I'm epsilon close? Geometrically, what will it be? Okay, there are lots of formulas, maybe. Okay, here, look at the intersection of the spherical cap with the tube. It has a certain area. We take the ratio of this area, this divided by the area of the cap, that's the probability. We have to bound this. It's like we have to get more local bounds from what we have done before. Here it's in formulas, okay, you can read it. The probability now that the Frobenius condition number is greater than or equal 1 over epsilon with respect to this uniform probability in the disk is the probability that the distance is the most epsilon, blah, blah, blah. Is the probability that you're in the epsilon tube. And this is this volume ratio. Volume of the intersection of tube with spherical disk divided by volume of disk. Okay, we want to upper bound this. And hopefully it's not too large. Okay, makes a lot of sense, I think. I hope you are all with me. Always like people nodding in the audience. Usually it's only few people that are nodding. Okay, so what I'm going to do, it will not be completely rigorous. Again, it's heuristic, but I think all the essential ideas will be there. I mean, the ideas, and then one has to do the details. So I just write B for the spherical disk. The first step is, this ratio, I replaced by first order approximation. So what I do, of course, this is a little bit of cheating, but here I intersect my curve with the spherical disk, so I get just this piece of the curve. And then I say this piece of the curve multiplied by 2 epsilon, this is a good proxy for the volume. So of course, one has to do in more detail with the curvatures, but not now. Just for the idea. So roughly this will be the volume of the intersection here of the curve times 2 epsilon divided by volume of B. Hopefully it makes sense. Okay, then again, but then we can reuse the Poincaré formula. With the Poincaré formula also works just for the piece of curve, doesn't matter. So Poincaré tells me the volume of this piece of the curve divided by the volume of the hyperequator. Okay. Is the expected number of points. You take a random plane, then you intersect your plane with the piece of the curve in the number of intersection points divided by 2, blah, blah, blah. As before, we know this can be, well, almost surely it's finite, so we can assume it's finite. Then this can be bounded by the degree, so I have the degree here, times the probability that the plane meets the sigma. Okay, I can upper bound it. So I can put here the larger quantity, the probability the plane meets the B. Okay? Good. Mm-hmm. It's always difficult to show proofs on transparency, so let's try. Otherwise, I can use the board. So now let's put this together. Now this ratio here, this I need to bound. So again, I have to adjust it a little bit. So I have this volume of the piece of the curve divided by volume of hyperequator, and then, you know, I do this. Now this ratio I have just bounded by d times probability of plane meets B. Now I have to multiply with this. It's the volume of the hyperequator by the volume of the sphere. This is roughly square root of the dimension, roughly. Like I had it before, okay? There is some constant. You know, this is roughly. And then, well, how about this? We can do maybe a little bit of cheating. The volume of, what is the volume of B? The volume of B, what will it be? So what did I say? I have some A bar and then I have some radius sigma. So it will be roughly, volume of the sphere times sigma to the, what is, P is the dimension of the sphere. I think P is the dimension of the sphere. So I put here a P. P stands for number of parameters. Of course, this is not precise. If I were in Euclidean space, it would be fine. Otherwise, there are some curvature is not precise, but forgetting the idea, I think it should be okay. Yeah? So that's why I put here 1 over sigma to the p. Now it's, okay, I hope when I move on to the next slide, now you remember this. Okay, it will reappear. Okay, I have to write it. Maybe let me write it. I said roughly d times the probability that the plane meets a random disk times square root of p 1 over sigma, just to remember. Okay. Good. So in this setting I had the P was random. So what do I do? What I'm saying now, okay? The idea is just to change a little bit. Before the B, the disk was fixed, but the plane was random. But I can say, okay, the plane is fixed and the disk is random. Just for estimating, the point is now estimating this probability, I should say. B is fixed, I have a random plane. What is the probability that I meet? I can also assume that the P is fixed and the B is random. It doesn't really matter. So, and then you see, what is it? So this was, okay. This is written here. Here it is. The cap, I have drawn my circle. The cap meets the circle if the center is sigma close to S1. So I have here my disk B. It meets S1 if the center of the B is sigma close. So what I want to say is that this probability here can be written as a ratio of volumes. Here I have the volume of the tube around S1 with radius sigma. Before it was a hyperequator, now it's a true circle divided by the volume of S. That's an equality, it's not just approximate. So now what is it? let's take it easy. What is this? Roughly. So I would say this volume, roughly now, this is roughly the length of S1, this is 2 pi, roughly 2 pi, times the volume of a cross section of a p minus 1 dimensional ball of radius sigma in the cross section. This is not exact, but roughly. Can you imagine? So in this picture, okay, I would say this area is roughly 2 pi, actually. And now, instead of having this, I just say 2 sigma, which is, of course, not precise, but roughly. Yes?
There's something I don't understand. Shouldn't the center of B always be A bar, which is fixed?
The center of B?
Yes.
That's what I'm saying. B, the center of B was fixed, P was random. Mm-hmm. I wonder what is the probability that the disk meets the plane. But then I say it's easier for analyzing, it's easier to say the plane is fixed, okay, but the B is random. Okay, that's the. Okay, now hopefully, now one has to plug in stuff. Okay. Right. Okay, you know, it's rewritten. I did it well. This ratio, now I just copied the formula, which is now also on the board. And then, what did I do here? Right, I substituted here a formula for the probability. The 2 pi, of course, I forgot about it. I just put the sigma to the p minus 1 here as a, okay? So I plugged it. Then I simplify, and I get degree times square root of p divided by sigma. It's important that you have this cancellation. You have sigma to the p minus 1, you have sigma to the p, get 1 over sigma. So degree square root of dimension divided by sigma. Okay, all together, okay, let's put together everything, summarizing. The probability that the Frobenius condition number is greater than 1 over epsilon have roughly upper bounded by degree by this. So the degree was n, p was n squared, I take the square, it's again n, so I get an n squared. I have n squared epsilon over sigma. Okay, it's the same upper bound as before, only difference now I have this sigma, which I didn't have before. Okay, now of course there were, was not everything kosher, but using some differential and integral geometry, this can be turned into a proof, yielding an upper bound of essentially this order of magnitude. It's, you know, considerable more technical work, but basic ideas is that. Okay, and again, we see we lose a factor of n compared to Mario Schäbor's bound. Okay, but of course this proof has the advantage that it works, you know, large generality. Okay, we only need a determinant is a homogeneous polynomial of degree n, nothing more. Okay, and then I can state a general result for smoothed analysis. So, I mean, you can, okay, this applies in a general context. What do we get? So the sigma, let's assume abstractly sigma is the zero set of a homogeneous polynomial of degree d in R to the p plus 1. Okay, so, and then I can define a conic condition number. I just imitate the Eckardian theorem. No, it's an abstract setting. I say abstractly, the condition of A is norm of A, this will be Euclidean norm, divided by the distance of A to sigma. Abstractly, okay? You're skeptical.
Do you mean S or sigma? Or?
This is wrong. This is a sigma. Thank you. I have to correct it. I didn't catch that one. Thanks. Thanks. Ah, good. And then we had the theorem, same guys, Felipe, Martin. General result on smoothed analysis. So if you take any sigma, t must be larger than this and that, and then we get this upper bound, okay? Probability that this conic condition number is greater than or equal t with respect to this uniform probability on the disk, supreme of all centers, is bounded by a constant degree times number of parameters divided by sigma t. This general, okay? And for, right, and then for the expectation of the logarithm, often it's the logarithm of the condition number that is relevant. You get something, you know, this logarithm of dp over sigma. It's general. The ideas are, I explained you the ideas. Okay, you just need a little bit more math to do it. Here's an application, here's another problem. Eigenvalue computation. Okay, so let's see. What is the set of ill-posed inputs? It's when two eigenvalues coincide. It's the zero set of the discriminant. Okay, it's also a hypersurface. Okay, the problem is compute the complex eigenvalues, set of ill-posed inputs sigma, consists of the matrices having multiple eigenvalues. It's the zero set of the discriminant. We can, of the characteristic polynomial, if you think about it, you see it has degree n squared. It takes some time to understand this, okay? But you know all this. This is a typical task in computer algebra. How about the condition number? Now, this is, you see, this is, one has, it's very important to understand that this is not the same condition number as before. It's a different problem. It's the problem of computing an eigenvalue, not an inverse, okay? So you understand? Then if you do the, I mean, so if this is defined, so by the general principle, general definition. Maybe, or not quite, I mean, because you can have several eigenvalues. So it depends, you have, given is the matrix, in general you have n eigenvalues, and for each eigenvalue, there is one condition. Okay, so let's take the maximum of all of those. This would be this kappa, and then Wilkinson, prove this upper bound. So it's not an inequality, but it's an upper bound, so some square root of 2. But otherwise, you can upper bound it in this geometric way, as I had before. This requires proof. Okay, norm of A divided. You can read the proofs in our book, for instance, if you want to go to, don't want to go to Wilkinson's paper. But then once you have this characterization, you can say, okay, now I can work with this. Characterization. I can use all these geometric ideas and you get the corollary from the general result I had. The expected logarithm of this eigenvalue condition number is bounded by this. Now for ln n to the fourth over sigma. It's a smoothed analysis. You just get it. Okay? Right. So actually, this eigenvalue computation. So this is, doesn't refer to an algorithm, it's just about the condition number. So in the next second part of my presentation, I will talk about polynomial equation solving, and I explain you the framework, which is more involved than what I explained to you today. But maybe I can say here what is interesting. So we talked about polynomial equation solving, many principles. But then you can apply this for this simple problem. This the problem to find an eigenvalue of a matrix. And to come up with an algorithm that is numerically stable, okay, one has to say what it means, but it is on average polynomial time. That was an open problem. It's quite strange that for such a basic problem, nobody was proved. Nothing was proved. For the QR algorithm, which is usually with shifts, there is no theoretical result. So I wrote the paper in the end. So Diego Armentano, maybe I can write it here. Diego Armentano. And Carlos Beltran. I mean, most of the people who ever worked on this are co-authors of these papers. I'm glad we found a referee. And there was me, Felipe Cooker, and Mike Schub. Actually worked on it independently, but then we came together. And then, we came up with an algorithm, which is a homotopy algorithm, and you can only understand it after listening to my second part of the talk. So what I want to say, it's so general what we do. We developed it for a very complicated framework. We go back to the simple problem of eigenvalue, eigenvector computation. You can apply it, and you can do the analysis, and you get it. So this was accepted for Journal of the AMS. It's a long and rather technical paper, so it's technical. But, right. So why I'm telling you this, because this is, Of course, this condition number here plays a crucial role for understanding this. And in that paper, it's not just a condition by itself, but it's considered in the connection with an algorithm. Okay, so how is my time? How much more time do I have?
9 minutes, including questions.
9 minutes. So, okay, let's ask. I have more stuff, but the question is, shall I start with it now, or are there questions so far for that? Yes? Oh, this is a very good question. So I can tell you another story. Okay. It's so. Okay, when we teach linear algebra, okay, then when we do linear algebra, how do we get the eigenvalues of a matrix? These are the zeros of the characteristic polynomial. But in numerical analysis, I remember in Zurich, there was a professor, and he said, never use the characteristic polynomial. Okay, but he never, I mean, but why? Well, there are examples, it's obvious. So what I did, okay, I did another thing. We tried to find a theoretical justification why it is not good to use the characteristic polynomial for computing eigenvalues, okay? Something everybody in numerical analysis, they just know it, but don't prove it. So what you do, what we did was the following. So in the simple setting, I just take a matrix A, independent entry standard Gaussian, and then you look at the characteristic polynomial. We put here a T, it's the characteristic polynomial. Well, this is now a random polynomial. Okay, the coefficients have some distribution, which is, I think, some complicated distribution. Now, if you say, let's find the zeros of this. So in principle, there is no problem. I mean, if you have, let's say you have a polynomial, okay, here. You think about finding zeros to a polynomial. Here you may say the coefficients are independent and maybe again standard Gaussian, but that's not the setting that you have here. So you can study this problem by itself. And then you analyze some algorithms. For instance, the homotopy algorithms, I will talk next time or so. But there is no problem. That's a good situation. Okay, solve, find zeros, using some, I mean, I haven't defined it, some homotopy method. Oh, it's a good situation. Okay, you believe me. So, but here one observes problems. Okay? Of course, here it's a different distribution. So what we did, there is a condition number. I mean, you can define a condition number. Maybe I just call it kappa of f. So it's the maximum, okay, for each zero, you have a notion of condition number. It's the way I explained at the beginning. You just have to agree on the norms, what kind of norms to take in the spaces. And then you get this condition number. So if I say a good situation, I think means the expected condition number of this is not big here, but here it is big. And so what we proved that here, okay. So we have, I can write it here. Kappa A is a condition, let's say expectation. Okay, and this is something like something like 2 to the n. Okay. While here, okay, if n is the degree of f, so I don't know by heart, but here it will be just, it will be certainly polynomial. Okay, let me be generous. Okay, I mean, we know more about it, but it's polynomial. So this is some, but the funny thing is people in numerical analysis didn't like the paper. We sent it to several journals, they all rejected it, because they said they knew it already, kind of. But it's no proof. Does it answer your question? I mean, or do you have more? Others? Okay, maybe I can add something here that, of course, there is, maybe if you are interested in that, there are papers by Arnold Schönhage. There's a paper that it never appeared in a journal. It's called, in the title is something like Fundamental Theorem of Algebra, etc. It's like a technical report, Tübingen. I think it was in the 80s. So it never published. But there, if you find at the end of this technical report, you find very interesting comments on that problem. Because if you are allowed to adapt your precision, then you can use, I mean, you can find the eigenvalues accurately using the characteristic polynomial. You just have to adjust your precision. So there is no problem with it, okay? But on the other hand, if you look how in numerical analysis you compute with the floating point, and we have this fixed precision. And if you are in that situation, you are running into trouble. But if you do like Schönhage, who had this Turing machine implementation of his algorithms, you adjust your precision, then it is no problem. So I think there is a lot of confusion about this, about the true nature of this. And, yes? Here, I think it has to. If you look at our proof, why is this condition here so large? Then actually, it's a similar phenomenon as if you take this Wilkinson polynomial. The Wilkinson polynomial, that's what people usually look at, is this. But we don't, 20, it has to be 20. Okay, this is the Wilkinson polynomial. Then if you write down the coefficients, then you see that there is an enormous difference. Okay, I don't know the number, but this number is kind of small. It's just the sum, okay, of 1 up to 20. But the constant coefficient is enormous. So they are enormous, they are unbalanced. And I think that's the main reason for that. I can tell more you about it, because I think there is, okay, but maybe not for everybody. So let's talk about that. Yes? This is the condition number for finding zeros of polynomials, which I haven't defined formally here, but that's it.
And so the input are the coefficients, but the expectancy is not the expectancy on the Gaussian distribution, but on the distribution given by characteristic polynomial.
Here, the x. Okay. I'm not sure I understand the question. Here, are we here?
Yes, here.
So the matrix A is But then,
is that the definition on the, okay, yeah.
But then this kappa, it has some distribution, which is just a consequence of the distribution you chose here. By the way, here, in this condition number, there are several choices, depending on what kind of norms we take and so, but it doesn't seem to make a big difference. So we put several ways to define the condition number. The phenomenon was the same. Yes. What I wanted to say, maybe when Bernard asked this question, how should one, if you have this polynomial here, how should we measure errors here? So should we do it norm-wise or component-wise? I think that makes a big difference. So in our analysis, we did a norm-wise relative error. We also did some experiments, yeah? And our experiments confirmed our theoretical findings. I'm almost done. But the thing is, if you do, instead of norm-wise, you do component-wise, relative error, then we performed some experiments here, and then what we got was much, much smaller. So the catastrophe was not there anymore. And we are still trying to understand. Experience tells us it's bad to use the characteristic polynomial. We get a theoretical confirmation with this normalized relative error. If you do component-wise relative error, doesn't seem to, we didn't prove anything, but we looked at the computation. That doesn't seem to be a problem. So one has to find an explanation. But the explanation has to do what with the algorithms. So it's something we don't really understand. It's very interesting, I think, that such a problem, so basic, most people believe they know, but we don't know. We're done with the time, okay? Thank you very much.